And finally, a thank you to Warren. Warren introduced us to Matthew, and that's enabled this session to happen. And thank you to everybody in the membership who voted on a poll that we ran a few months back asking which topic you'd like Matthew to cover. The future of customer experience was the most popular one that came up, and so that's what we're covering today. A few more people are going to keep joining us as we go through, but I know Matthew has a lot of exciting content to cover, so I think it'd be best if I hand over to Matthew. He can introduce himself better than I can. And make a start. So thank you very much, Matthew, for joining us.
Well, thank you. So I suppose with no further ado, my name's Matthew Griffin. A lot of people call me a futurist. I'm the founder and CEO of the 311 Institute and the World Futures Forum. And from a futures perspective, we typically go all the way from present day to 50 years out. So we help companies and governments basically all around the world understand what the future of their industries, their organizations, their markets, basically their products will look like, could look like over the next sort of 50 years. So we split the future into two. On the one hand, basically, we look at the near future, which we really sort of regard as, you know, 0 to 20 years out. If you're a multinational organization or any form of organization, typically you care more about the next 3 to 10 years, maybe 20 years, a little bit of a stretch than you do the 50. But if you're a large multinational organization, a visionary organization, or even a government, you typically care 30 to 50 years out. Simply because that's where we're talking about the future of energy, infrastructure, jobs and skills and all those kinds of things that we hold dear. Now, from my perspective, I work with a whole variety of different organizations around the world. So you're using the products from all of these different companies right now, whether it's companies like Arm, whether you are trying to get on a plane with companies like Airbus or a flying taxi with Airbus. Disney, when we have a look at the future of content and synthetic media, so that's things like deep fakes and being able to use artificial intelligence to create a blockbuster Marvel movie, I go all the way through to typically sort of 2050, 2060 there. I work with Microsoft on the future of artificial intelligence. And as we start talking about the future of artificial intelligence and the cloud, of course, we work with wonderful organizations like Utilize. So if you are looking for cloud implementation, Warren's your guy. And I'm sure you'll find him knocking around somewhere basically on the call. Hey, Warren. So with no further ado, I often come across this. This is something that I struggle with relatively regularly, less so now than I did in the past. Something called the time traveler's dilemma. Now, what I mean by that is if I went back, say, for example, to the 1970s or 1980s and said, I have perfect knowledge of the future. In the future, in the year 2010 to 2020 to 2030, we will have a requirement for data scientists, people who can build artificial intelligences, cybersecurity experts, and everything else. I'd have been laughed out of the room, frankly. When I started having conversations basically with leaders in the past and said, but I'm serious, there's this thing called the internet. It connects 3.5 billion people. It's transformed humanity. From top to bottom, I'd still have been laughed out of the room. Even 10 years ago, if I'd went and had conversations with the CEOs of most of the automotive manufacturers and said, in 5 to 7 years' time, you are all going to be spending hundreds of billions of dollars pivoting your companies, building electric cars that drive themselves, that you no longer sell to consumers. Again, I'd have been shown this, the futurist's equivalent of the door. And everything that we see today has been built really over the past 10, 20, 30 years. The transformation that we're witnessing today is absolutely staggering. And disruption is everywhere. Yeah, as a keynote speaker, normally you can find me on these kinds of stages. You know, I was recently up at the Science Museum presenting on an IMAX. It's a 5-story screen, tall screen. But now you can find me in my virtual studio. However, again, when you think about the technology that's driving just this studio alone, things like 4K streaming, UHD sound, 300 megasecond internet, 10 years ago, I couldn't have done this and you couldn't have been watching this broadcast basically in this kind of format. Even Zoom calls 10 years ago basically would have been difficult. Now, as we start sort of the event, I think personally, as we start talking about customer experience, I'd like you all to go and get a coffee. Maybe a molecular coffee from companies like Atomico. Basically, we're The coffee is made without the actual coffee bean. You can 3D print yourself some chocolate if you've got one of those 3D printers at home. And while you're doing that, I'm going to just roll VT and show you how we can use some of these different exponential technologies that we're going to be talking about throughout this presentation to solve world hunger. Meet Ian the chicken. This is how we use one chicken to solve global famine using technology and human ingenuity.
We've all been there, right? In the grocery store. Oh, I'll just buy this meat. And there it is. And all we have to do is buy it. We don't have to think about what it took to make that chicken in that nice packaging. But the reality of the way that it came about, it's incredibly unsustainable. And that's one of the biggest problems facing humanity right now. But we figured out a way to solve it. The whole idea is that that chicken in itself has an unlimited source of itself, and there is a way where you can take just a handful of cells and keep growing them essentially infinitely. For those very first cells, it was important to us how we got the cells, not just that we got the cells. We came up with the idea to use one feather from the single best chicken that we could find.
Let me pick down.
First thing we need to do is we need to identify a cell that we are going to use as the basic starter material. And then what we need to do is find a food for it to grow in. So we have to identify the right set of nutrients that will cause the cells to multiply, but not just multiply, but do so quickly and into high densities.
It was an out-of-body experience to sit there and eat a chicken, but have the chicken that you're eating running around in front of you. You don't imagine doing something like that.
So today, there are hundreds of powerful technologies that are letting us literally turn science fiction into science fact. Now, when we start having a look at this from the customer experience perspective, as Steve Jobs famously once said, start with the customer experience and then work backwards. That's what I've tried to do with this presentation. I'm trying to empathize with all of you. Think about your experience, the experience you want to get from this presentation and the environment that you're in. Now, every company's challenge basically is actually being relevant tomorrow, particularly when we start having a look at the new normal, sort of post-coronavirus, basically normal that we all sort of keep trying to talk about and actually keep trying to reach. In addition to that, so you think I've frozen. In addition to that, and I didn't freeze, by the way, real time is the new minimum. You know, when we start having a look at the experiences in the products and the services that we want to consume, we don't want to wait 5 seconds. We want it now. Hyper-personal is the new personal. We're going to be delving into this. And then from a customer perspective, you want the customer experience and the customer wants their experience to be as frictionless as possible. Ideally, if they can experience your product, your brand, your service without really having to lift a finger, if it just happens magically, then that's superb. Now, from a technology perspective, technology is increasingly let us do a whole variety of things. Some of those things include the democratization and the decentralization of every single product and service on the planet. Now, what I mean by that is if you took this lady and you took her into the middle of the desert 10 to 20 years ago, and you asked her to do something productive, when you came back in an hour's time and said, well, what have you actually done? She would have just said, well, I haven't done anything. I've been sort of trying to commune with nature, but there's none here, so I've been building sandcastles. Nowadays, though, so you give her a smartphone, you give her an internet connection, and there's a whole variety of different technologies that will let her be connected in the middle of the desert, things like low Earth orbit satellite systems that we're seeing sort of come through today. And all of a sudden, she can do everything. She can take online courses. She can go and buy products. She can go and sell products. She can take a health check. So, for example, when we start having a look at things like health checks, increasingly you can use the smartphone sensors that you have. You can use the camera and you can use artificial intelligence. Someone's cleaning the windows actually behind the camera. That's it, that's a bit distracting. You can use artificial intelligence and the sensors basically within your camera to do a variety of different things. She can be sitting on the sand taking a selfie, and that selfie can tell her whether or not she has the onset of things like cancers. She can take a picture of her skin and see whether or not she's getting skin cancer from the desert heat. She can even use her voice basically to analyze whether or not she has the onset of heart disease, dementia, PTSD, depression, all these kinds of different things. These are increasingly not smartphones. They are tricorder devices. In addition to that, she can buy and sell shares. She can have a pizza delivered to her via drone. There's a whole bunch of different things that she can do now that she's sat in the middle of the desert. These technologies and services are increasingly low cost, and they are increasingly democratized. So when we start having a look at what we can do with that, now from an industry perspective, the vast majority of industry executives still sit within their own bubble. And what I mean by that is they will have a look at all of the different innovations and things that are going on within their own industry, but they'll often just either blatantly ignore or not acknowledge anything else that's going on in any other industry. Yet every industry is connected. Take energy, for example. We already see a point in time where the cost of energy is going to be zero. The cost of generating electricity with solar panels is now 0.2 cents per kilowatt hour. But when we start talking about customer experiences and building products, when we start thinking about traveling to Mars, like Elon Musk is trying to travel to Mars, some things need to be over-engineered.
Falcon Heavy is configured for flight.
T-minus 15, standby for terminal count.
SpaceX Falcon Heavy, go for launch.
10, 9,
all systems count.
8,
set booster ignition.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition.
So that's the future of transportation right there. I'll give you that one as a freebie. So when we start talking about engineering products, basically there are some things that you need to over-engineer. One of the things you don't need to over-engineer is a toaster. So this is the noun toaster, basically it's from Bugatti. Now, when I say toaster, what I really mean basically is a toaster that cooks vegetables and steak as well as toast. It comes with its own smartphone app. Basically, it costs $1,000. It's obviously for high-end individuals, basically, that don't have an oven. If you don't have an oven, basically, in your Beverly Hills mansion. But oddly enough, despite all of this engineering effort that's gone into making this hybrid toaster, it can still burn the toast. What's that about? So when we think about customer experiences, we need to think about the customer experience backwards by seeing how customers are going to be using the products and services that we're developing. And then we need to bake in convenience. Now, when we start having a look at the exponential future, increasingly the future is faster than ever before. Now, what I mean by that is if you went back 50 years and you wanted to disrupt a global industry at global scale, it would have generally taken you about 50 years. Nowadays, it can take you a single day, and I've got an example for you in a moment. Now, if you consider this, we have more people on the planet who are connected. We have 3.5 billion people connected on the planet. We have the other 3.5 billion people being connected over the next sort of 5 to 10 years using a whole variety of different technologies, 5G, 6G, low Earth orbit satellites, high atmospheric platforms, and all kinds of things. Now, Pokemon Go, as an example, reached 50 million users within about 19 days. Call of Duty was downloaded and used and consumed by 100 million users in 6 days. Facebook's cryptocurrency Libra, had it been approved by regulators, Facebook could have built their product, launched their product today, and then it could have been used by 500 million people. It could have been used by 2 billion people on the planet within a single day. And in the words of the G7 central bank leaders, it was a significant enough product development, basically, that it could have not only transformed the world's global financial markets overnight, but it could also have relinquished the state's control of money because of the way that it aggregated different fiat currencies together to keep its value stable. So we've already reached the point where digital products and services and an increasingly connected society are able to disrupt global businesses and industries and behaviors and cultures and everything else, basically, in a single day. However, you know, when we have a look at the future, it's increasingly complex, not less complex. It's also getting more confusing. And part of the reason for that is, this is my starburst. It tracks over 180 exponential emerging technologies over the next sort of 50 years up to about 2070. When you have a look at all the different technologies that we can use to combine together to build next generation products or services, we have over 450 incredibly powerful technologies. We have, for example, 3D printers. That's on-demand manufacturing that disrupts the $10 trillion manufacturing industry. Bioreactors like Ian the Chicken, that disrupts and democratizes access to food in new ways. We have biotechnologies, basically, like CRISPR and gene editing, that help us cure people using in vivo gene editing tools. Some of these technologies were also used to create the latest latest COVID vaccines. We have in the communication space 5G, 6G, HAPS, or low Earth orbit satellite systems. In the energy space, we have a path to creating silicon solar panels, basically, that are 132% efficient, bearing in mind that today they're about 17%. And all this is a story in itself. From a computing perspective, we have GPUs that will be replaced by IPUs. We have artificial intelligence. We have AIs that have been 3D printed. We have artificial intelligences that have been made out of DNA. When we look at computing, we already have quantum computers that are 100 million times faster than today's traditional computers already here. One in China recently did a calculation that would have taken a classical computer 2.5 billion years, and it did it in a minute. We have DNA computers, molecular computers, liquid computers coming through. On the electronics front, we have flexible electronics, electronics that reconfigure themselves. This is crazy and it's nuts. When we start having a look at everything else, robots, we have molecular robots that we've already been using to create molecular assemblers that make lithium-ion batteries for the electric vehicles that you're driving. And it goes on and on and on. This is a veritable wormhole. But from a customer experience perspective, as a consumer, I don't care about any of that. I just care about the end experience. And that's where we look at things like brain-machine interfaces, augmented reality, virtual reality, mixed reality, and all these other kinds of things. We even have holodecks, basically, we even have prototype holodecks coming out with Roddenberry Studios that use parallax screens. That's a whole conversation in itself. So anyway, as we start having a look at the future of customer experience, privacy. Today, privacy is a myth. when we have a look at offline and when we have a look at online privacy, we know that when we go online, everything is monitored, everything is tracked. Facebook collects over 450 data points on you and then compiles them together in different ways to stick you into different buckets and demographic groups. However, when we start having a look at offline, yeah, there's innovations coming through there as well. Now, from an online perspective, we're all used to cookies basically sort of, you know, following us and tracking us everywhere. These are now going away in Chrome's latest update. We're going to be using federated artificial intelligence that actually anonymizes user data instead of being able to use and collect data that identifies you personally. We collect data basically on your friends because, frankly, if your friends, it's called the N plus one effect, if your friends like pizza, you probably like pizza. So we're not just watching you from a privacy perspective, we're watching your friends, your relatives, your family, and your extended networks and relationships. However, everything is about you. And when we start having a look at the different ways that we can really start trying to understand you as a consumer, you know, your fears, your desires, your needs, your wants, your personalities, your behaviors, your background, everything about you. We have a whole variety of new things in our kit bag. So for example, courtesy of Planet Networks, we can now scan the surface of the Earth with a 1 meter resolution in high def. We have image sensing systems coming through that are now going into satellite systems that will reduce that resolution to 50 centimeters. Now, what this means is that satellites, commercial satellites like the ones from Planet, are literally able to track and monitor everything on Earth in real time. They can tell basically where you live, they can tell where you've gone in a day. It's TiVo for Earth at a very high level. Now, when we start bringing this down, we have what we call loitering drones. They sit at about 30,000 feet. They're already being used in Baltimore. They're also called persistent surveillance systems. Again, like the satellites, basically these are ultra high resolution, basically, and they can track entire cities in real time. So they can see where everybody is going to, where everybody's coming from. So that's sort of really high level. But as we start zeroing down, we bring it basically from the 30-mile view, high view, down to street level. We have CCTV cameras everywhere. Now, from a CCTV camera perspective, we're not just taking video feed. I can apply machine vision to that video feed. I can detect loads of different things about you just from that video. I can detect your intent to criminality. I can tell whether or not you're lying. I can tell if you have any underlying health conditions because of the way that you walk. I can tell whether you are happy, upset, or depressed by the way that you walk. You know, if you're depressed, you're generally going to be shoulders and head down. In addition to that, I can tell your character and your personality. I can do that just with a single snapshot courtesy of Israeli technology companies. This is surveillance, basically, that is literally getting into some incredibly uncharted areas that you can buy all the data from and you can aggregate that together. And that's the tip of the iceberg on that one. When we start having a look at the smartphones in our pockets, again, I showed you earlier how you can do a health check using these things. But increasingly, as I'm talking, they can tell me basically what my mood and my emotions are, how I hold the phone, the regularity that I use it, what I type, who I communicate with, you know, so online, offline merges again. Just the angle at which I hold the phone can tell companies like Facebook a huge amount of information about yourself, whether you're happy, sad, depressed, the speed that you pick the phone up and all that kind of stuff. Moving on, when we have a look at the smart speakers in your home, they ultimately know when you bought dishwasher detergent and they know when you're going to run out because they can listen to the number of times you put the dishwasher on. But in addition to that, they can listen to your voice. They can figure out if you have coronavirus, if you've got COVID. That's courtesy of University of Michigan and Caltech, because when you get coronavirus or when you get COVID, your voice changes. It affects your vocal cords. So these particular devices are picking up huge amounts of information, not just about your voice, the high pitches, the low pitches, even the resonances that you can't actually hear. But they can tell what's going on in your house, where you are in your house, where you're moving from and to, whether or not you have pets, the size of those pets. They can listen to your voice and they can start figuring out basically your background, your ethnicity. They can figure out basically what your education profile probably looks like. If you speak very well, you know, you might have gone to a good school. If you don't speak very well, you may not have gone to a very good school. You start tracking, you start combining this together with GPS data and all the other sorts of things. I can understand huge amounts of information about you. When we start going a little bit deeper, things like these smartwatches. Increasingly, as sensors start improving, we are getting to the point where the sensors in these devices are able to track you and monitor you at a biochemical, a biomechanical, and genetic level. So, for example, imagine basically in the very near future, your Apple smartwatch saying, I think you need a drink. I think you need to eat X, Y, and Z because your blood sugar is low. Etc. This is called the quantified self. That's a whole topic in itself. So increasingly, these wearables basically are starting to really get under our skin in a metaphorical way. The Roombas basically that you might have, you know, the robot vacuum cleaners, they're going around your house. They're actually mapping your house. We can tell basically what sort of house you live in. And whether you are rich or poor, based on the number of rooms you have, the size of those rooms, we can also figure out where you spend most of your time. This is like indoor GPS. When we start talking about Wi-Fi routers, courtesy of a company called Emerald, which was recently spun out of MIT, I can do an artificial intelligence firmware update to your Wi-Fi router, and I can turn your Wi-Fi router into the equivalent of a radar or sonar device that can track you at the millimeter level. Now, when I say track you, I mean a number of different things. Firstly, they can track where you are in the house, but they can track your microfacial movements. They can track your posture. They can track basically, they can track your emotions. These things can tell you with a 96% accuracy whether you are happy or sad because they can literally see you smiling, albeit using radio frequency. So these things are a data source, you know, privacy or not. In the future, basically, we have fully autonomous cars. These are going to be packed with sensors. They're going to be feeding information back on, again, health information, emotional information, mental health and wellness information, you know, what you're doing, where you're going, what you're watching on Netflix, basically all this kind of stuff. We go even further. Now, thanks to companies like Me23, we can do genome sequencing, and we can do it for pretty much sub $100. We have companies like Nestle in Japan that are now starting to analyze your DNA and your genome, and then 3D print specially designed nutrition for you. So you order little pouches, and it comes, and it's been in these particular foods have been tailored to your exact biochemistry, but also your exact genetic makeup. However, let's get inside your head, because we have a whole variety of new brain-machine interface technologies that are coming through. Now, these typically come out of the healthcare space with ALS, where we can use brain-machine interfaces to read people's thoughts. We can read sentences, we can reconstruct text, and that's to help ALS patients communicate with loved ones. But increasingly, I can use brain-machine interface technologies to literally pull images out of your head and stream them to YouTube. So hyper-hyper-personal is the new hyper-personal. And if you didn't believe that I can't pull images out of your head using brain-machine interface technologies and stream them to YouTube, here we go. This is out of Japan. And the resolution's now increased, and so on and so forth. And then just for fun, just to prove that we do live in a science fiction world, why don't we have a hologram as well? The kind of Princess Leia hologram that you actually see in Star Wars. So on the left, we have brain-machine interfaces and artificial intelligence that are reading your brain in real time to recompile images that you are thinking about or seeing, either or. I'm in your head. On the right, we have a genuine hologram. So these are kind of the holograms that you see in Blade Runner 2049. This is the real deal. It's made using femto lasers. It's not augmented reality. It's not using fake glass. It's not using being done using glass or any of those kinds of things. And then as a weird fact for you, in 2020, Microsoft patented the use of brain-machine interfaces to help you make money, in other words, mine cryptocurrency with your mind. So you can literally use your brain to make money. So science fiction is actually increasingly dull when you start comparing it to some of the things that we can already do today. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. Now, those brain-machine interfaces, technology increasingly gets smaller and smaller over time. It gets cheaper and cheaper. This is the world, these are the world's first, I mean, they're smart glasses, they do augmented reality and all that kind of stuff, but these are the world's first glasses that pack a brain-machine interface that can read your brain waves into a pair of relatively common garden glasses. Now, from a black box perspective, we take all of this information about you and we feed it to an algorithm. Now, at the moment, I see a lot of our experiences are relatively dumb and reactive. I go onto Amazon, I go and look at a product and it says, people like you who looked at this product also considered these products, these kind of optimization and recognition systems that we see. However, as we start getting to the point where we can gather so much information about you that even your partner would be surprised, we can do lots of other things. So, for example, if you take the photo of this woman, all of a sudden, basically, we can use artificial intelligence to say, well, she wears clothes like this, basically, therefore, she's this type of person. Therefore, I'm going to recommend these types of fashions and these types of clotheslines to her. In addition to that, basically, we've actually used machine vision, whether it be in a smartphone or a CCTV camera, and we can actually tell that she's got the onset of heart disease. Because her skin flushes in a very subtle way. We can tell basically her emotional mood. So we can say, well, you know, she's either lost basically or she's a little bit upset. So because we know that she's upset, we could pop something up on her smartphone saying, by the way, Starbucks are doing a promotion, free coffee, and this is the closest Starbucks to you. This is how you get there, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We have hyper personalization and we have commerce on steroids. Again, tip of the iceberg stuff. Increasingly, machines basically are getting smart and proactive. They're getting intuitive and they're evolving. So the artificial intelligences, this algorithmic society that we live in today, is already evolving. We have artificial intelligences from companies like Google, OpenAI, Microsoft, and others that are literally designing themselves and designing better algorithms to keep improving the models. And some of the algorithms that these self-evolving artificial intelligences have created are at least 30% better and more efficient than what the world's top experts have put together. All these machines are increasingly connected and trusted. When we talk about connected, we start looking at hive minds, where a robot on one side of the planet can learn something, and because it's connected to the cloud and artificial intelligence, it can pass that knowledge and that training to the robots on the other side of the planet. So think about an autonomous car based on one side of the planet that sees a strange shape, doesn't know what it is, then it figures out what it is. It can then teach the rest of the fleet what that thing is, whether it's a good thing, a bad thing, whether it's safe, whether you should avoid it, whatever it happens to be. But from a trusted perspective, as we start taking the recommendations that all these different artificial intelligence algorithms are actually pushing our way, like people like you also bought this, or by the way, I've looked at your closet and I think you'd look good in this particular sweater. Increasingly, we start passing trust to the machines. And when we start passing trust to the machines, by about 2025, machines will be making more transactions, more brokering, more decisions, and will be more trusted than most humans. Think about your autonomous car. Today, you get into your regular car, you pump the brake. In the future, an autonomous car will make that decision of when to put the brake on for you. Elevators that you get in, you trust that they stop, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We are already starting to trust machines more and more and more. Now, I said that I've said a little bit sort of before this presentation that I can also find and see a way, basically, where your fridge can make you money. So this is a smart fridge. Basically, you can buy a smart fridge basically from anywhere. A smart fridge is typically a fridge that is connected. On the one hand, it can tell what's in there in the fridge, but Giving you a little bit of an example here of how I can get this to buy your next car. This particular fridge says, Warren, you've run out of milk. Would you like me to buy some more milk for you? And Warren says, yes, I would. So this smart fridge is connected to the blockchain. It starts forming a consortium with all the other smart fridges because Warren isn't the only chap who's run out of milk. Millions of people have run out of milk. And so these fridges get together and they negotiate and haggle a better price. So you normally buy your milk for £1, but these smart fridges can say, well, we've actually secured a deal with Tesco's. We've managed to get it for 80 pence. Would you like just to buy that? Or do you want me to buy it automatically for you? Warren says, yes. Now this is where these machines increasingly from companies like Samsung can start saying, well, I just saved you 20 pence. You know, what do you want me to do with that? You know, and Warren thinks, well, just invest it for me. You know, it's already connected to bank accounts and everything else. Just invest it to me. So the machine goes off. It's already profiled Warren's appetite for risk and everything else. And it's found a great investment opportunity. So every time the fridge saves some money on its purchases, it puts it into a piggy bank account. Now, over time, those piggy bank accounts basically increase and increase and increase. And just in the UK, this kind of model will actually unlock about £300 billion worth of additional value. At some point, that machine can say, Warren, I noticed that your current electric car is getting a little bit old in the tooth, is getting a little bit old. I actually took a lot of the money that I saved you and invested it into a very, very high risk hedge fund. And actually, that hedge fund just came back with a 300% return, bearing in most quantitative traders are coming back with 64% returns. And I've actually now managed to secure you this. It's a Terzo Millennio from Lamborghini. Now, what's special about this is an electric hypercar that's due in 2030, but it doesn't have any batteries. So it's an electric hypercar that doesn't have any batteries because the shell of the car itself is something called a structural battery. So you're welcome. We have a way for your smart devices to save you money, to pool that money together, to invest that money, and then start bringing new offers to you and say, do you want this? And by the way, I've arranged someone to pick up your fancy Volkswagen, Warren. You're welcome. Now, from a familiarity perspective, again, you know, today, basically, if we've sort of got queries, 80% of customer service queries are now using bots, sort of conversational-ish artificial intelligences. Increasingly, we can use our voice to buy products and to access customer service. So for example, Alexa, what's my bank account? Alexa, order me something. Alexa, I mean, how many of you have now got Alexa going off basically in your homes? Sorry about that. So we've got behavioral computing coming through that allows you to start interacting with machines in a more natural way. With 5G, 5G and augmented reality start unlocking what we call the spatial web. Now, what I mean by the spatial web is you can use smart glasses or your augmented reality phone. You could point your phone at any product in the real world. It could be a tree, and it will say, by the way, this tree is this species. And if you want to buy this type of tree, your local garden center has got this type of tree. It's 50 quid. I can have it delivered for you when you get home. And I also know a gardener who could actually plant it for you if you want. These are the connected experiences that we're already driving. However, you know, when we start having a look at augmented reality smart glasses, are you going to wear those if you don't already wear glasses? Probably not, frankly. It's a cultural thing. So when we start talking about augmented reality, this is a smart contact lens. It's the world's first. It's from Mojo Vision, and it is the world's first smart augmented reality contact lens that you can buy and stick in your eye. They're here. You can also start buying products based in virtual reality. So you could go onto a car, you could sit on your sofa, go onto Ocado, and rather than going to Ocado's app or website, you could just go and buy your tangerines in virtual reality from the virtual reality store. And wouldn't that be amazing? But again, when we start talking about these experiences, when we start fast forwarding, that headset's rubbish. No one's going to be going and mooching around a virtual reality store with a massive headset on because it's painful and it's a nuisance and it's expensive. So again, technology always miniaturizes over time. So here are the world's first smart virtual reality glasses. Using products like metamaterials, we can really start packing these. We can start bringing high definition virtual reality experiences to a pair of regular glasses, and these will get smaller and neater over time. So again, this is Anna. Yeah, so we now start talking about digital humans. So I hired Anna
Morning,
a while
John.
Ago.
Here's a quick 2-minute summary of all of today's news from your LinkedIn network. I also noticed you seem stressed and heard your company's planning redundancies. Would you like to review your investments, savings, healthcare benefits, and pension plans? They're in the dashboard, and if you like, we can review them together and look for better alternatives.
Some of the things we can do when we personalize your experience and then we connect your experience and these platforms to lots of other platforms basically are staggering.
I am the latest result in artificial
intelligence. But you can't talk to Anna.
Which can reproduce the capabilities of the human brain with greater speed and accuracy. But my friends call me Kooky.
I understand. What is Kooky? I do not know what you mean by that.
I am the latest result in artificial intelligence, which can reproduce the capabilities of the human brain with greater speed and accuracy. But my friends call me Kooky. Seems pretty clear to me.
Oh no. I've never heard of artificial intelligence. I do like chatting online too, though.
So I am teaching you something new. Artificial intelligence is the branch of engineering and science devoted to constructing machines that think. Who is Mark Zuckerberg?
I have no idea who that is.
What do you think of Facebook?
I don't use it much. You can use a program called Skype. I use it all the time. You should try it.
Who do you think is smarter, Blenderbot or Kooky?
I think Kooky is the smarter one, but I think it is Kooky that is smarter.
Thanks. I am trying to become more intelligent every day.
Thanks again for chatting with me.
You came to the right place. All I do is chat.
I like to chat too. It is a great way to get to know each other. Thanks for chatting.
Yeah.
So that is the world's most bleeding edge conversational artificial intelligence. She's called Kooky. You can look her up on YouTube. So we move from relatively static digital avatars like Anna that I showed you to machines that you can genuinely talk to. And Mark Zuckerberg was actually Facebook's, was based on an artificial intelligence from Facebook, and frankly, pretty rubbish. Kooky was made by a hobbyist. Now, when we start taking these conversational artificial intelligences that we'll see coming through really in about the next year, 2 years with some form of anger, and we start combining them with high definition avatars, we can end up with digital humans with neural network brains that can respond to you and talk to you like real people.
Well, this is a bit awkward.
For whom? Us or the humans?
Without a doubt, the bipeds. What if it's a real fire and they never come back? What if it gets into our circuits and we melt? What if this is the end of everything as we know it? What then?
Wow, I sure lucked out getting stuck in a room with you.
I didn't mean to ramble on.
I was just playing with you.
Well, how come I've never met you before?
I'm in demand, jetting all over the world. Conferences, festivals, French Riviera. People love me.
I can see why.
Sorry, I didn't quite get what you said. Humans mumble too. Guess they programmed you well.
I'm Roman.
And I'm Sam. If it weren't for the laws of physics, I'd reach through this screen to shake your hand.
And I'd hand you a martini, shaken not stirred.
That's more like it. So what do you do to fill in time when the humans go home?
For me, I'd like to be an author. So I'm writing a book.
Interesting. What's it called?
Do AI get a buzz from short circuits? How about you? What do you dream about being?
The President of the United States. Stranger things have happened.
Well, it's been a, how should I say this?
A deep learning experience.
And as for artificial intelligence politicians, China now has an artificial intelligence foreign minister. But automation only goes so far. You still need humans in the loop somewhere. And when we start talking about the future of real personalization and products, as I gather more information about you, I can all of a sudden predict what you need, when you need it, and where you need it. So if I can tell from the skin tone whether or not, and your smartwatch, whether or not you're dehydrated, and I can go and remind you and say, by the way, go and get a drink. I can use 3D printing, basically. I can use a variety of different sort of technologies, basically, to make you food, basically, while you're working, and so on and so forth. So kind of like a concierge. But increasingly, let's start accelerating again. People don't think that we can create machines that are creative or that can innovate and design and develop and manufacture new products. They're wrong. They're already here. They're called creative machines. They're based on artificial intelligence. So imagine this. Imagine an artificial intelligence knowing so much about you that it can start creating an ideal product for you. It then uses simulation engines, which are sort of like virtual worlds, to design and develop that product. And then it uses a 3D printer to print it for you. Or if it's software, it uses something called a machine programmer, which is an artificial intelligence programmer. Companies like Microsoft and Google have one. They're called Bayou and DeepCoder. So now I can start understanding what you want, what you want, where you want it, and how you want it delivered, and I can make software and hardware. So this particular video is, and we're almost there, this particular video basically is from OpenAI, where we used a virtual world to create the world's most dexterous robot hand, but we did it in a matter of weeks. Now, this thing had over 800 years of experience packed into it in a couple of weeks, and can you do this?
We're trying to build robots that learn a little bit like humans do, by trial and error. What we've done is trained an algorithm to solve the Rubik's Cube one-handed with a robotic hand, which is actually pretty hard even for a human to do. We don't tell it how the hand needs to move the cube in order to get there. The particular friction that's on the fingers, how easy it is to turn the faces on the cube, what the gravity, what the weight of the cube is, all of these things, it needs to learn by itself. The interesting thing is that kind of standard techniques in robotics haven't been able to scale to that complexity that we see in a robotic hand. Humans have evolved to be able to manipulate and operate our hands. So there's a huge amount of learning that's happened through evolution to get us to this point as a species. And the robot has to learn all of this from scratch. Instead of trying to write very dedicated algorithms to operate such a hand, we took a different approach where we create thousands of different simulated environments and learn to do the task in all of those. And hopefully, a robotic hand will be able to do it in the real world as well. This means like thousands of years of experience that this neural network has had in simulation. Every time the algorithm has gotten good at the task, we make the task harder. That's really crucial because it needs exposure to really complicated environments in order to eventually be robust to the real world.
So we have machines that can understand your needs and then design, innovate, and develop and manufacture products in the blink of an eye almost. So just to give you an example of some of the companies already using these creative artificial intelligences, we've got Airbus, who are using them to design the new A330neo. We've got InSilico, where an artificial intelligence designed 30,000 new types of drugs in 21 days. That type of technology was used in the latest coronavirus vaccine programs, by the way. We've got NASA using these to develop lunar rovers, basically that are 30% lighter than anything that anyone from JPL basically can manufacture or come up with. We have Under Armour, who recently used artificial intelligence to design the Architect sneaker that can be 3D printed in the back. Under Armour normally takes 18 months basically to go from concept to product on the shelf. This was able to do it in under 2 days. So what happens basically when these artificial intelligences understand basically that, you know, you run in around this neighborhood. There are potholes, basically it's tarmac, it's whatever it happens to be. And then they can take all of the biometric and biomechanical data about you to create a shoe or design a shoe that you can then 3D print at either your local UPS depot, basically, or in your house, or at the Under Armour store. In addition to that, when we start having a look at synthetic content generators, we have AIs that are now producing music. You know, you're feeling a little bit depressed or upset. Well, we have artificial intelligences like Endel, which have now been signed by Warner Music, that can understand that because they're getting big data feedback on you. And they can start producing the right type of music that they think that you want to hear. They write books. They can write procedural games courtesy of courtesy of AIs, basically from companies like NVIDIA and OpenAI. They can create virtual reality worlds as well, again, courtesy of companies like NVIDIA. So we start moving from humans creating content to machines creating content to machines then creating autonomously procedural content that is personalized and tailored to the individual in real time. That changes your customer experience. And then as for the lady that I mentioned earlier, you know, one of the machine vision systems picked up that, you know, something seemed to be wrong with her heart. So what about this is the ultimate customer experience. This is going to be full scale in about 15 years. Now, that AI could say, by the way, I think that there's something wrong with your heart. So what I've done is I've communicated with your local hospital. They've already got your genetic profile on record. And what we've used, what we've done is we've used that to 3D print you a new heart. So I've booked you in, go in, have a transplant, and then live your life. By the way, I've also given you 10 years back.
The 3D heart includes, for the first time, cells, blood vessels, ventricles, and chambers. Produced by researchers at Tel Aviv University, the tiny heart is the size of a rabbit's. But Professor Tal Dvir says it is a scientific breakthrough.
This is the first time that a whole cellular heart with blood vessel is printed. And another major breakthrough is that it is printed from the materials of the patient itself.
The team reprogrammed cells taken from a small biopsy to become stem cells, and then differentiated them to become cardiac cells and cells that form blood vessels.
And the biomaterial, the collagen and the other sugars that in the tissue, is processed to become a bioink. And together, when mixed, we have bioinks for the heart and bioinks for the blood vessels. And then we use a 3D printer to print whole hearts with the major blood vessels.
It takes 3 hours to print one heart, measuring about 2.5 centimeters. Doctoral student Adav Noor says it will take several years of technological development before they can create a full-size, functional, pumping heart.
I'm not sure it's going to serve ourselves in the next few years, but for our children, I think it's going to be maybe an amazing opportunity, especially for heart disease patients.
The researchers hope that in 10 years, every hospital will own printers that can make tissues and organs to be transplanted into patients. Faith Lapidus, VOA News.
So as we round out, that's got to be an example of the ultimate customer experience.
Can you hear me, Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
I'm just conscious of time, and we've got about 4 minutes left, so I've just suggested to everybody that if they have any questions, if it's okay with you, we can follow up with an email.
And yeah, then absolutely.
We've got just 4 minutes left. I'm not sure if you've got a watch on you either.
No, that's fine. We're done.
Perfect. Thank you so much. That was so fascinating. So much food for thought there. We do maybe have time for one or two if people have got another 5 minutes to hang around. I think, was it Chris asked one in the chat? Let's just come to that one first and then I'll come to you then. Chris asked, is there any element of the future of customer experience which isn't based around new technology? It's a bit scary, isn't it, Chris?
So there are. So one of my friends is a farrier and we haven't seen any robots that are able to shoe horses, although we do have robot vets now. One of the main takeaways basically I would give to Chris basically throughout all of this is we are increasingly automating the design and manufacture of products. We are increasingly automating the, shall we say, the customer experience and, you know, how customers buy. So things, you know, if these machines know that you always buy toilet roll, they know when you run out, they just send it. So there's a huge amount of automation generally coming into the space from all sorts of different angles. But increasingly, I think the one thing that will start differentiating more companies in the future, not fewer, is going to be the human experience, because I can talk to an artificial intelligence and have a conversation with it about how I hate your company because you did something wrong. But increasingly, I think that we're going to want to reach out and have a human connection. So ironically, I think human interaction is actually much more important, especially in the future, than it is even today.
Thank you very much. And Ben, I think you had a question as well.
Yeah, apologies. I joined late and this may already have been covered. And also this question is verging on a cliche now, but what safeguards exist, if any, to avoid the situation of the so-called singularity, where the machines become aware and decide that they're better off without us? What safeguards are being introduced? And apologies again if you covered this the beginning.
The answer is, so there is some, but it's all just talk. I'll give you an example. When we have a look at the singularity, so increasingly technology is moving closer and closer to us. You know, it used to be far away in a data center like a mainframe, then you had a computer on your desk. Now you have a smartphone, which is in your pocket. Then you have wearables. And then increasingly technology sort of is either part of us, whether it's on us or in us. But when we actually start having a look at the policies and some of the regulations and some of the debates and conversations that are coming through about the singularity, basically, and what happens basically when technology has fundamentally changed the human condition, those debates are happening on the fringes. I mean, I work with the vast majority of G20 governments, and this isn't even on their radars yet. You know, just some of the, just to put it into perspective, artificial intelligence is only really just being regulated, and it's being regulated in a very flimsy way. When we have a look at privacy, all of those things that I showed you that we can do to invade your privacy, for better or worse, those are already here. And yet the conversations about some of these topics haven't even started yet. And then when we do have a look at things like the singularity and using technologies for bad, we see the development of fully autonomous kill chains in particularly the US, Russian and Chinese military. But the generals involved go, there will always be a human involved in pressing the fire button. I know that's a load of hoo-ha, putting it politely, because all you need is one country to say, we've taken out the bloke that we were paying £50,000 a year just to push a button, and we've automated him. Russia has something called the dead hand system. Typically, we, from a government and a policy perspective and a regulator perspective, we regulate once the problem has already taken place. And then we go, rubbish, we should have done that sooner, and then we backpedal. And that's exactly what governments around the world are doing now.
Well, it seems ridiculous to me. When I was a teenager, I read Isaac Asimov's Foundation series, and it forecast precisely this. There have been at least 50 years, because it was written before I was born, for people to prepare for this. And, you know, as interesting as this presentation and the bits that I've seen has been, frankly, I find it terrifying. And I think things need to be done in order to address technology before it overtakes everything.
I agree. That's it. And unfortunately, so to put it into the words of people, if you saw sort of Facebook, you know, Facebook went to the US Senate about 3 years ago, and the US Senate was having conversations about the future of privacy and Facebook and social media and everything else. And observers said it was like watching Mark Zuckerberg explain technology to my grandparents. The people who are in power, who can create the regulations, develop the policy frameworks, lead the debates, create the consortiums, and you know, and pull all this stuff together, they have generally very little insight into what is actually already here, let alone what's coming. Hence, some of these videos. But yeah, I wholeheartedly agree.
Thank you, Ben. We're about out of time. I have to run away to get to other meetings. But I just want to say a huge thank you to Matthew. That was so fascinating, eye-opening, and quite terrifying. I agree with what some of you have said there, quite terrifying. But If any of you do have any follow-up questions for Matthew, we'd really appreciate it, Matthew, to be able to reply via email. So I know there were a few more things to touch
on. Yeah, just reach out.
Perfect. I'll connect you all via email as always. And yeah, thank you ever so much, Matthew. And thanks, Warren, for the introduction. Mind blown.
It's a pleasure. That's it. Take care, everyone. Goodbye.
Thank you very much.
Ta-da. All the best.
Bye now.